Welcome everybody to a new week. I hope this is a great week for you. I hope you've had a fantastic weekend. It's ready for Monday morning today. We've been doing a theme, looking at faith and breaking it down into different aspects. So we could talk forever on this most amazing subject. But we've been looking at a couple of things that faith is, and maybe a few things that faith is not. We've been looking at the scope of faith this last week, and we spoke about that beautiful verse where Jesus said, if you have faith the size of a mustard seed, then you can move mountains. And we've been looking at some of the mountains that maybe need to move. Remember, we said that a mountain is a metaphor just for anything that stands in the way of the will of God. He was not being literal when he said that, but he's certainly making a very strong point to us today. Anything that stands in the way of the will of God for your life and you becoming what God wants you to be, that's a mountain. And Jesus gives us full authority through faith to move those mountains. Now notice, you're the one that has to move them by using the faith that you have in a God who cannot fail. Now today, I would like to, in this coming week, have a look at some of the voices that get spoken to us that would suggest that we are what, in fact, we are not. One of the mountains that we have to move is very sadly the mountain of shame. You see, guilt is a thing that only the Holy Spirit can use to motivate us to change. When us preachers use guilt to motivate people to change, it's not fair, it's not right. And people can come to church full of guilt, and we just add a whole lot more to them. There's only one legitimate person who uses guilt well to bring about change. That is the Holy Spirit. So if I bring any guilt on you, please just ignore it. But when guilt goes wrong, as often it can, especially when it's been laid on by human beings, it leads to shame. And shame is a huge, huge mountain that people very often hide. They run from it. They pretend they don't have it. But they live their lives out of a feeling of shame. Shame that I've got this, shame that I haven't done that, shame that I've been caught with this. And guilt is one thing, but shame is entirely another. So this week, I'd like to talk about the mountain of shame that we need to get rid of. I'd like to take you to one of the most beautiful stories that you find in the Bible. It's found in 1 Samuel chapter 17. You will know it well. It's the story of David and Goliath. And I think that this story just epitomizes to us in the attitude of this young man, this young shepherd boy, what it means to deal with the issue of shame. You see, David stood before a 9-foot-9 giant who just laid shame on him. Shame on you that you're part of the nation of Israel. Shame on you that you would come and fight me. Am I a dog that you would come to me with a stick? And he just laid more and more shame on David. And David gives to us a key on how to deal with the issue of shame. You see, for David, it was not who he was that was important. It was whose he was. Because David answered the question so beautifully that Goliath asked him. He said, who do you think you are? Who are you that you would come and fight somebody, a hardened soldier, with me? Have you not seen my spear and my shield and my armor? And you, this little shepherd boy, come with a catapult and you want to fight with me. Who do you think you are? Now that, people, are the words of Satan. Those are the words that Satan will use. Who do you think you are? I know what you've done. I know where you've been. I know what you've said. And those are the words of shame that Satan will lay upon you. Who do you think you are? Now, if you want to be able to answer that question, it's not about who you are, because that doesn't mean nothing, but it means about whose you are. And when you are like David, David acknowledged, I am the son of the great God Jehovah. I am basically a child of the king. Don't mess with me. And his identity was not found in who he was physically or what he had achieved here on earth. His identity, which is just so important that you find that, was found in God himself. So when he stood before the giant, it wasn't about who he was. He said to the giants, I come to you in a name, the name of Jehovah, the God of Israel. And when we come with that name, our identity is secure. So when you stand against the giant of shame, you better know whose you are. Now, David, we often look at David and we think, well, what did he know about God as a father? Because that was a new concept to somebody from an Old Testament situation. But I would suggest to you today that at the benefit of retrospect and the benefit of scripture for us today, that if you are a child of God, that's who you are. And that's whose you are. God is your father. Now, sadly, in life, there are fathers that do not do well. There are fathers that do not treat their children well. There are fathers that do not love their wives as they should. There are fathers that are not so good. But God is not like that. God is a perfect father. And you are a child of God. And if we could just establish for ourselves the power of that identity, man, that would transform the issues of shame. Because God says, I've seen it all. There's nothing that I have not seen. I have forgiven you of everything. You are now a child of God. You will still hear the voice. You should be ashamed of yourself. You should be full of shame, because Satan wouldn't be doing his job if he didn't do that. And so he will lay shame on you. Don't argue with him. Don't debate with him. Just tell him whose you are. So when you hear that voice of Satan saying you should be ashamed of yourself, you'll know what to do. Guys, have a great day. We're going to talk the next couple of days to take this apart a little bit, if that's okay. I hope that it's of some use to you. Certainly, it has helped me incredibly. God bless you guys. Have a fantastic day. Bye.